Alright guys, back again with another video. Today I thought I'd talk about a little project I've been working on. I've been watching a couple of videos about getting old Amigas on bulletin boards using RS-232 and Null Modem cables. I found a particular gentleman's blog who got his Amiga 500 online using a Raspberry Pi. And this is something I've been really interested in. I've got this fascination about getting every piece of equipment on the internet, whether it be gaming consoles or old computers. And getting an Amiga 500 online is a pretty difficult task. In the old days, you could just kind of connect up using a modem and a dial-up modem, and that would work fine. But in this day and age of Ethernet cards, it's almost impossible to get one online. There's no network Ethernet type solution available for an A500 now. The ACA500, which I kind of did a bit of a mini review of in my last video, there is actually a clock port and the potential to get a network expansion, but at this point in time the A500 is one of the only Amigas that doesn't have a PCMCIA port or a Zorro port where you can actually connect a network cable or a connection or a card to. The 600 and the 1200 have the PCMCIA port on the side, and the kind of the big boy Amigas have the Zorro slots, which allow you to connect either PCI network cards or Zorro based network cards. So this is a fun little exercise, and I got this to work, and what I want to show you is how this all works. So basically, what you need to make this work is obviously you need an Amiga 500 to start with. Getting one that has accelerated CPU and more memory is advisable, of course. This will probably run on 68,000, but mileage may vary and stuff like that. This is the Null Modem cable. I got this from Micro Center. It's just fairly bog standard. There's nothing special about that. And what you want to do is basically, I think Dan Wood's video, he actually had his connected up to his PC. What I've got here is a Raspberry Pi. Now, these things, if you don't know, are mini computers that cost all of $35. And it's just basically a low power, low kind of spec mini computer that runs a variant of Linux. And these are kind of for hobbyists and to mess around with. But the cool thing about these things is it comes with an HDMI port, an Ethernet port, and a couple of USB ports. So you can plug it into a monitor, mouse and keyboard, and obviously have some kind of Ethernet connection to make it work. So what you actually need to get for this to make it actually work via RS-232 is an RS-232 expansion. Now there's two ways you can go about this. The first one is you can actually use the GPIO port inside of this thing, and that's like a TTL to RS-232 expansion, and you can pick those up for about $4 or $5 on eBay. There's a million people selling them. The second option is to use a, which is what I'm using. And let me see if I can grab it here. Just get behind the monitor here. It's basically a USB to RS-232 solution. And I'm not sure how that's happened. Let's pull that out. So something like this, where you've got a USB connection into your Raspberry Pi, and there's your RS-232 port or your serial port. Now I will say that I've heard mixed reports about these types of solutions. Some of them work, some of them don't work. The particular one that I'm running here is by parallax.com, and it's a revision B board, and I'm not really sure much more about what the model is, but it works fine. I think it's got the Max 3232 chipset, I believe that's what it's called. So your mileage may vary there, but this thing works fine, and this cost me all of $17 at Micro Center. So basically, total cost of parts here is the Raspberry Pi cost $35, and this thing cost $17, and I picked up a Null Modem cable as well, which was another, I think, $8 or $9. So, you know, pretty cheap, and I took a bit of a gamble because I wasn't sure if this was going to work. Like I said, the particular blog that I saw had was using a TTL to RS-232 and was going in via the GPIO connections inside the unit here, so I wasn't sure if the USB solution would work, but to my pleasure, it actually does work. So let me show you how this works on the Raspberry Pi side. So I'll be back here in just a second. Okay, we're back, and we're at the boot screen of the Raspberry Pi now, and I don't want to spend too much time messing with this, but basically the way this thing works is, as mentioned, we've got our Raspberry Pi connected, and we've got the serial, the USB to serial port plugged in, and if I can show you this here, as you can see, it's green, which means it's got a connection, well, at least it's ready to do some stuff. I'm sorry about the focus there. So if I log in to the Raspberry Pi here, and I got the login incorrect, what we want to do is we want to start a PPP daemon. Now, in the old days of modems and dial-up modems and stuff like that, PPP was the common standard of getting a computer online, and the way it works is it's called point-to-point protocol. And what that means is if you specify a host IP address and a destination IP address, you should be able to establish a connection depending on the type of and let me show it to you. Basically what this is doing here is it's saying, I want to start the PPP daemon with the USB device that we looked at before, and it's going to run at 19200 baud, or bits per second, kilobits per second, and the first IP address is the host IP address, and the second IP address is the destination IP address. Remember, we're talking about P2P, which is point-to-point, so there's a host IP and a destination IP. So if I run this script, the PPP daemon is going to be listening for a connection. Now, the reason why we can only use 19200 kilobits per second is because the Amiga serial port can't handle anything faster. I've tried it with faster speeds, and you just can't get a connection or a stable connection to work. So let's run this. Run this launch net. Now that's running, and in the background it's waiting for a connection. So what we want to do now is jump over to the Amiga side and show you how that works. Okay, so we're on the Amiga 500 here, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to start Miami, which is the TCP IP client, and this is the one I kind of recommend for Amiga 500s and kind of slower Amigas. Now, I've already got this preloaded, so I'm not going to configure it again, but basically, if you look at the hardware, we have a serial hardware, and we're using the built-in serial driver, and you can see the speed is the same. As mentioned, if we try to make this any faster, it doesn't work. You can't get an established connection to work. We don't have a dialer. Our interfaces is our PPP interface, as mentioned, and obviously Miami will have support for PPP, so does Amiga TCP and Genesis. I'm not sure about some of the other TCP IP clients for the Amiga, but I think all of them should work. And as you can see, our IP address is 10.00.2, which, if you recall, over here, is the is what the PPP daemon is kind of listening for. And our gateway is set to .1, and everything else is kind of normal.
Online.
You can see PPP01 is now online. And that's all there really is to it. So to prove this actually works, let's kind of run a couple of little applications. So I'm going to minimize this. Let's iconify. So now, if I run a telnet session, I'll run am telnet. And if I say I want to connect to 10.0.0.1, as you can see, we have a terminal session into our Raspberry Pi. So if I log in, oops. Got the wrong emulation. Yeah, I just need VT100. Let's try that again. And as you can see, we're in. I was trying to illustrate this thing here, but this thing will flash red when there's data flying back and forth. So we're connected. Anytime I kind of press a key there, you can see it's registering, it's sending those packets to the Raspberry Pi. So we can kind of take this further and show you some web browsing and some IRC. If you want to see how IBrowse works, it actually doesn't run too badly at that particular speed. This is IBrowse, and let's kind of just click on Amiga World. And there's our network activity there. Now remember, this is all across serial port. Pretty slow, but even still, this page seems to load pretty quickly, so It's not too bad, you know. It's a pretty good kind of solution. Now, of course, if you want to start talking about downloading files, that's going to start getting pretty slow. I don't recommend you actually download files because you will be locked in at a pretty slow download speed. You'll never get anywhere near as fast as dedicated network speeds. But that's IBrowse. So we've got our web browser. Let's just do one more test and jump over to AmiNet. Yeah, so we're in there. That's not terrible at all. And if we flick over to IRC, show you how that works. Connect up. So there you go, we're in. We're on the EAB IM.net channel. Now, the last thing I wanted to kind of show you was what I've managed to do is get the Raspberry Pi. So that particular script that I ran, what I've done is I've set it up in the startup. So you don't actually have to have a mouse and keyboard. You don't have to log into the system to run the script. And the goal of this was to basically just have it plugged into the Amiga without any kind of mouse and keyboard and display. So you just turn the power on and wait a minute for the Raspberry Pi software to boot up. and then get connected. So let me just kind of show you how that works. What I'm going to do is shut this down. And if I just go offline. Yep, alright, so I'm offline here, and I've already got this loaded in the startup. So if I basically unplug the display, and there's no easy way of restarting the Raspberry Pi except for a three-finger salute. There's no kind of hard reset switch. Let me just put the camera down here for a second. So I'm just unplugging the keyboard that I had. So now I've just got the power connected, the Ethernet port, and the serial port, or the USB to serial. And if you just let this kind of boot up, give it about 45 seconds, I've got that particular script running in the startup. So like I said, the goal of this is just to have it kind of sitting behind the Amiga, waiting for a connection, rather than having a display to have to run it every single time. This is, like I said, this is kind of like a ghetto network adapter, and that's how I'm kind of treating it as. So I think that should be enough time. Let's try jump online again. Probably just not enough time yet. Oh, there it goes. We're connected. So as you can see, it's just the PPP daemon is running in the startup, and we're back online. So again, should be able to jump in our web browser just to make sure it works. Click on Amiga World this time. There you go, it's loading up. Let's try Amiga.org. This actually runs pretty well considering it's an A500 with an O30 accelerator. This is only a four color screen, and I don't want to start cranking up the colors and the resolution. That really eats my chip memory. I only have 512 megs of chip memory in this particular A500, so as you can see, we've already lost about half of it. So this is loading the Amiga.org page, and this is a new site that I've never been to before, so it's going to take a little bit longer, but it's loading up the page fairly quickly, all things considered. Now, I have heard reports that there are more optimized serial devices you can try, and I will actually see if the ArtSir device and some of those other serial device replacements actually will help. I would like to actually get the board rate speed up higher than 19200 board, but we'll see how we go there. But in any case, I just wanted to show you this cool little experiment, and I will finally say that this is not my invention or creation. Connecting computers via RS-232 is something that people have been doing for years, and this particular one with the Raspberry Pi, I came across on a blog on a particular gentleman's page that he had already done. The next thing I'm interested in doing is getting my X68000 connected up. I know there's a TCP IP stack, and it certainly comes with an RS-232 connection as well, so I'm going to see if I can get that online, and once I do manage to get that online, I will put up another video. But yeah, I just thought I'd show you this cool little experiment or project I've been working on. And if you want to get your A500 online, this is a pretty cheap and easy way to do it, at least certainly until there's a dedicated kind of network solution for it. But in any case, guys, thanks for watching, and I'll catch you again. Bye for now.